Praise team and musicians, welcome and good morning. Thank you for being here at Quail Springs Baptist Church. We're delighted that you are with us this morning. Now, as praise team has just led us today, we want to say a special word of thanks and farewell to Graylin Stewart. Graylin, we appreciate you, brother. He is going to be moving out of state. And so since we've begun this work and this service, this 9:30 service, Graylin has been a part of it this entire time. Let's tell him thank you. Perhaps you're a guest with us this morning. We want to know that you're here. I want to invite you to do something, is to connect with us with a connect card. You'll see those in the pew rack just ahead of you there. Or you can also go online to qsbc.org/connect-card and fill out that information there. That'll work either way. Today is the day that we are promoting. This is one of the strangest promotions I've ever experienced in my entire life, even as a preacher's kid. But we want you to get connected in a connect group. And so today, obviously you're on campus. If you would just step outside when we dismiss, right outside the exit, right around the corner, there are some folks who would love to help you get connected with a group on campus today. But we also offer opportunity with hybrid groups, those groups that would be meeting on campus, but also with video like Zoom, and then classes that will continue to meet, connect groups that would meet by Zoom only. I want to encourage you with your giving. Thank you for your faithfulness as we worship the Lord through our tithes and offering each week. You can do that online at qsbc.org. /give, but then also you'd notice that there are offering envelopes in the pew rack ahead of you today, and then we have offering boxes so that you can place those in those as we exit this morning. Let me pray for us as we continue to worship today. Father, we thank you for the opportunity to gather and to worship. Lord, we thank you when we read Psalm 32 that tells us of the joy that we have when our disobedience is forgiven, when our sin is put away. The only reason why that happens today is because of Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection. Nothing about ourselves. So as we gather today, as I stand behind this cross, Lord, we turn our mind to think on you. Lord, we thank you for the forgiveness and the new life that you bring to us. And we worship you. We celebrate you this morning. And Father, we thank you that by your Spirit that you are here with us to speak to us. We thank you, God, for our pastor. So as we open your living word today, we pray that you'd prepare our hearts, even now, to speak to us. God, thank you for your blessings on our lives in every way. And we thank you for your financial blessing. So we pray, Father, that as today, as we worship you through prayer and through study of your word, through song, we also worship you through our tithes and offerings. We lift them up to you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Thank you, Brother Ray. As we work our way through, take our little journey as we worship, think of the words we're going to sing. We're going to talk about thanking God for this incredible creation, this great world that we live in. Then we're going to challenge one another to be committed to Him, to live our lives for His glory. And if anyone is seeking the Lord in this place today, our final song will be just for you. Let's stand as we sing together.
For the beauty of the earth, for the glory of the skies, for the love which from our birth over and around us lies, Lord of all, to thee we raise this our hymn of grateful praise. For all who on Christ may be.
you. Be seated, please.
Good morning, and it's wonderful to see you in the Lord's house today. If you have a copy of God's Word, take your Bibles, turn with me to the book of 1 Corinthians, and today we're in 1 Corinthians chapter 8. 1 Corinthians chapter 8. And today in 1 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 1, Paul is continuing to address different questions that have been posed to him by the believers in Corinth. And the next question he comes to is this, beginning in verse 1 of 1 Corinthians 8. Now concerning food offered to idols. Now some of you have been just hoping that somebody would address that issue for you. What do you do about food offered to idols? I know some of you were driving into church this morning and you said to your spouse, I hope he'll say something today, because we're just struggling trying to figure out whether or not we should eat food offered to idols. The truth is, that's not an issue that we actually wrestle with directly day by day, is it? Now, I've been in places where that was a real issue. I've been in places overseas where pastors and believers are struggling with how to address that question, because idolatry and eating food offered to idols is a real thing that they face. But here's what I want you to hear me say. I cannot think of any question that hits at where we are today and what we face day by day than this question that the church in Corinth asked 2,000 years ago. What do we do about food offered to idols? Because here's what they were asking. What do we do, and how do we act, and how do we make decisions, and how do we decide what's right and what's wrong when we're faced with something that's not specifically addressed by Scripture? When God doesn't say clearly, do this or don't do this, what are we supposed to do? And I faced that question myself as a dad several years ago. Our son Joshua was about 5 years old, and when he was about five, a movie came out. It was a live-action Scooby-Doo movie. So there's this movie coming out. It was Scooby-Doo, and they had computer graphics generated Scooby-Doo, and then there was a live-action Fred and Daphne and Velma and Shaggy. Y'all know what I'm talking about, Nadia? Okay, so you're familiar with the Scooby-Doo literature. You know what's going on there with that. So I wanted my son to see this Scooby-Doo movie, and more than that, I wanted to see the Scooby-Doo movie, because I was a Scooby-Doo fan from the time I was a little kid, so I wanted to see this Scooby-Doo movie. The problem was this: when the Scooby-Doo movie came out, it was rated PG, and my son was not allowed to go see PG-rated movies. We didn't take him at that point in time, never taken him to see a PG-rated movie. And so the movie came out, and I said, hey, Joshua, I want to take you to see the Scooby-Doo movie. He said, Daddy, I can't go see that movie. It's rated PG. So somehow or another, he was able to tell that it was rated PG. So that messed up my plan to begin with. He said, it's rated PG. And he said, I can't go see it. Now, I knew that there was no verse of Scripture that said, thou shalt not take thy son to see the PG-rated Scooby-Doo movie. I knew that. I was 99% sure that verse of Scripture wasn't in the Bible anywhere. I also knew that there wasn't a verse of Scripture that said, take thy son into the Scooby-Doo movie, enter the theater gladly with popcorn and rejoice. I knew it didn't say that in the Bible either. So what was I supposed to do? Well, the answer from Scripture was very clear. Because my son, in his own heart and his own conscience, believed that it was wrong for him to go see that movie, guess what we decided to do? We decided not to take him to see that movie, because to do so would hurt where he was at that point in time spiritually. Well, the same issue was at work in the church in Corinth. And that was, there was a question about whether or not to eat meat that had been sacrificed to idols. Now, Paul here is not addressing idolatry itself. As we move through these chapters, you'll find in chapter 10, he addresses idolatry specifically in that chapter. And there's no question in the Word of God, idol worship, worshiping something or someone in the place of God or in addition to God, is always wrong and always forbidden in Scripture. But that's not the question at work here. The question here is not the question of whether or not to worship idols. The question here was whether it was okay to eat meat that had been offered as part of a sacrifice in the idol's temple. And in those days, that would have been a social issue, and that would have been a financial issue for believers. On the one hand, it was a social issue. You see, in those days, the idol temple and the worship around the idol temple, after they would offer up the meat, there were huge feasts and parties that they would have, and to participate in the life of the community involved eating meat that had been sacrificed to idols. And so there was a sense that it was a social issue, and then even more pressingly, it was a financial issue. There were two basic sources of meat in the first century world, especially in the Greek and Roman cities. There were two sources of meat. You could go and buy your meat in the marketplace, where the meat was often very high priced, or you could buy meat that had been sacrificed to idols. Somebody had taken this meat, offered it up to the idol in the temple. Some of the meat was left there in the temple. Some was eaten by the person who made the offering, and then some of it was sold at deeply discounted prices in the idol temples. And so the question was, can I eat this meat that I can get at a great, great discount since it's been offered at an idol temple? So what was the answer to the question? We're going to see how Paul answers it. And as we look in this text of Scripture, by the way, Paul begins addressing this question in chapter 8, and he really continues in some way addressing it all the way through chapter 10 of this book. And so it was a big question, and it required a really thoughtful and spirit-filled answer from the Apostle Paul. So I want to give you three ways that Paul answers this question about what to do when you're faced with a decision that on the surface is morally neutral, but a decision that may impact other believers around you. And Paul tells us it's an issue of balance. He gives three dimensions of balance and balancing the right things when you're making these kinds of decisions. And so first of all, the Bible talks to us about balancing knowledge with compassion. Balancing knowledge with compassion. When you're faced with a decision and you don't have a clear word from Scripture, whether it's right or wrong, make sure you balance what you know and what you know is true and factual with your love and your compassion for others. So continue reading with me in verse 1 of the text. The Bible says, "Now concerning food offered to idols, we know that all of us possess knowledge. This knowledge puffs up, but love builds up. If anyone imagines that he knows something, he does not yet know as he ought to know. But if anyone loves God, he is known by God. Therefore, as to the eating of food offered to idols, we know that an idol has no real existence, and there is no God but one. For although there may be so-called gods in heaven or on earth, as indeed there are many so-called gods and many so-called lords, yet for us there is one God the Father, from whom are all things and for whom we exist, and one Lord Jesus Christ, through whom are all things and through whom we exist. However, verse 7, however, not all possess this knowledge." And we'll stop right here. In those verses, Paul is talking about balancing knowledge with compassion. He says, we all have knowledge. And there was a specific issue that they had knowledge about. Look down in verse 4 of the text. What they knew was that an idol has no real existence and there is no God but one. He says, we understand this. He says, we know, we have knowledge in our minds. We know the facts that these idols that are being worshipped have no real existence. In other words, they are not really gods. They are not really goddesses. They are not really lords. Now, if you look in chapter 10 of the text in verse 20, there Paul says that to worship an idol is the same thing as worshiping a demon. So there's a demonic aspect in idol worship. But he says the idol itself, I'm talking about the piece of wood or stone or metal or whatever else, that in itself is not a god. There's only one God. It's the God from whom we exist and have all things. There's only one Lord, Jesus Christ, through whom we exist and for whom we exist. And so the Bible says that, but the Word of God says, look again in verse 7, not all possess this knowledge. You see, there were some believers in the church who really were unclear about whether that idol, I'm talking about that physical idol, whether it was really a spiritual entity or not. And so when they saw their fellow believers going to the idol market and buying food and then eating that meat that had been sacrificed to idols, for them that was a real issue that they thought, man, I just don't know. This doesn't seem right. This seems like you're participating in idolatry. And here's what Paul was telling these believers. He says, don't allow what you know. Don't allow the fact that you've got all your facts lined up. Don't allow that to become more important than showing love and compassion to your brothers and sisters in Christ in the church who may not know the same thing you know. Does that make sense to you? Nod your heads yes if it makes sense. Don't allow what you know, and in fact, he says, you may not know all that you think you know. Look there again in verse 2. He says, if anyone imagines that he knows something, he does not yet know as he ought to know. You may think you got all the facts together and you still don't fully know. He says, it's more important to get the love right than to prove that you have all the facts right. That's true in any relationship. That's true in a marriage relationship. That's true in a family relationship. And that's true in our fellowship as believers in Jesus Christ. It's more important to get the love right than it is to get all the facts right. Again, we're talking about in issues and decisions where we don't have a clear word, yes or no, from God. It's more important to get the love right and the compassion right than it is to get all the facts right. Verse 3, if anyone loves God, he is known by God. The way we come into a relationship with God is not necessarily by having every fact right, but instead having our hearts right, loving God, and through loving him, he knows us. We have that relationship with him. There must be a balance of knowledge with compassion. You say, why would the church in Corinth make such a big deal over whether or not to eat meat? And they might look at us. Everybody still with me right now? Y'all know I love you, don't you? Y'all love me, don't you? All right, they may have looked at us. We may look at them and say, why would they make such a big deal about eating meat? They might look down through the centuries at us and say, hey, church, why are y'all making such a big deal about wearing masks? Y'all still love me, don't you? Now, listen, I know that there are facts that people have on one side and facts that people have on the other side, and we could debate those facts, but the Word of God says even if all your facts are right, that there's the attitude of love that says, okay, I want to do what's compassionate and kind to others. And so here at Quail Springs during this season, we have strongly encouraged people to wear masks. I'm not wearing a mask right now because I'm far away from you, and we've sort of cordoned off the splash zone so nobody's getting spit on while I'm up here preaching. I don't have a mask on right now, but when I'm walking around, I have my mask on. Why? Not because of being convinced necessarily of one set of facts or another set of facts, but just to say, hey, there are people who are vulnerable. There are people who really have health considerations that they're thinking about. And there are people who just have fears and concerns. And I'm terrible at wearing a mask. I forget that I have it on. Yesterday, Michelle wanted to take me out to eat at a place just to get a cookie. And she got me this frosted cookie, and I was on my way. I had my mask on my way out to the car, and I looked at that frosted cookie. I said, I got to have some of that frosting. I stuck my finger in there and put the frosting all over my mask. I forgot I had my mask on. But I'm wearing it, and I would encourage us when we come together as much as possible to wear our masks just as a way of saying, okay, we want to be compassionate. We want to be courteous. We want to be considerate to those who are around us. That's just one application of it. But there's a balance here that Paul calls for. The Word of God calls for a balance between what we know and our compassion and love for one another. Then I want to move on and show you a second area of balance that the Word of God calls us to. The Bible talks about balancing individuality with community. In making decisions, we have to balance individuality with community. So we're in verse 7, and we're going to continue reading through the text. And there Paul says, however, not all possess this knowledge, but some, through former association with idols, eat food as really offered to an idol, and their conscience, being weak, is defiled. Stop right there. He says, all right, now you know that an idol's nothing. You know there's only one God, there's only one Lord. There's only one God, He created everything. There's only one Lord, that's Jesus Christ, through whom everything exists. He says, you know that, but there's some, even in the church, who don't fully possess all this knowledge. And for some, again in verse 7, some, through former association with idols, they used to be part of idolatry. They used to go and worship in the idols' temples there in Corinth. They used to offer up this food offered to idols. They were part of that, and they eat that food as really offered to an idol. He says, you know better. So many of you know better. You know that that meat is just meat. It's not evil meat. It's not demonic meat. It's not at the cellular level evil or bad or in any way. It's nutritious meat. But there are some who don't understand this. And when they eat, they are associating it with idolatry. And for them, look at what it says. It says their conscience, being weak, is defiled. And he says, you've got to consider them. There's a balance that has to take place constantly in the fellowship of the church between our own individuality and the community that we're in with other believers. God doesn't call us to be Lone Ranger Christians. God doesn't call us to live this Christian life on our own. And so we can't just say, well, this is good for me, and so therefore it doesn't matter what anybody else, how anybody else feels about it. No, the Bible says we've got to consider others because in their case, their conscience, being weak, is defiled. That word defiled means to be contaminated, soiled, or hurt. Someone has said that your conscience is like a little metal ring with three prongs on it. And when those three prongs are in the right place in your heart will feel fine. But if that ring gets twisted and those prongs begin to move into the wrong places, then it will hurt your heart. And so that's what was happening for these weaker believers. Maybe they had just come out of idolatry. Maybe they didn't fully understand everything they needed to understand from Scripture. But as a result, for them, when they ate that meat, it caused them to be defiled. It caused that ring to turn and their conscience to be hurt. Look in verse 8. Paul says, food will not commend us to God. We are no worse off if we do not eat and no better off if we do. But take care that this right or this authority or this freedom of yours does not somehow become a stumbling block to the weak. For if anyone sees you who have knowledge eating in an idol's temple, will he not be encouraged if his conscience is weak to eat food offered to idols? And so by your knowledge, this weak person is destroyed. Literally, this weak person destroys himself, the brother for whom Christ died. And so here's what Paul was saying. He says, even though you understand and you have knowledge, if you go into that idol's temple and you eat that food, a weaker brother will see you, and that will either cause them to think less of you and your testimony for Christ, or worse yet, it will cause them to defile their own conscience and to do something that for them violates their conscience, and to do that is to sin. Years ago, I had a good friend who, he and I grew up together. He was about 4 years older than I was. But when he was around 16 or 17 years old, my friend got more and more involved in drugs and alcohol and just a party lifestyle. And he just sort of disappeared from our radar screen for about 9 years. And during that time, he just was involved in a debased, reckless, wild life. And then when he was about 25 years old, God began to deal with his heart. He came to rock bottom, and he just realized he needed the Lord. He got his heart and his right life right with the Lord, and he and I began to renew our friendship. And although he was older than I was just doing everything I could. By this time, I was about 20 years old. I was doing everything I could just to encourage him and to help strengthen him in his faith. Well, he had lost his driver's license as a result of driving intoxicated, and so I would take him places from time to time. Sometimes I'd take him out to eat, or sometimes I'd take him to, if he needed to get to work or something, I'd take him around. We were driving in the car one night to get something to eat. I had on the radio, and we were just listening to whatever was on the radio, just radio station, probably rock and roll, classic rock, something like that playing. And we're listening, and as we're listening, a song comes on. And my friend says, "Man, when I hear that song," he said, "that's a song we'd always drink. When we drink, that song would be playing. When we do drugs, that song would be playing." He said, "When I was involved in all the life I was in, that I can remember that song." He said, "When I hear that song, it just takes me back to that time." I turned the radio off, and I just asked him, "When you hear that, does that make you want to go back to that lifestyle?" He said, "Yeah, it brings everything back to me." He said, "All those memories are associated with it." Now, was there anything wrong with that song? Honestly, I don't know. There may have been something wrong with that song. But for him especially, there was something wrong with that song, because it took him to a place spiritually and morally that he didn't need to go. And so he didn't need to hear from me an argument as to why it was okay to listen to that song. He didn't need to hear from me my position as to why I had freedom and I was able to listen to that song. It didn't bother me, so it shouldn't bother him. He didn't need to hear that from me. What he needed me to do as his brother was to do what? You tell me. Turn off the song. Why? Because I didn't want to do anything that was going to cause him to stumble and to fall back into that sin. So there's a balance between individuality and community. Take your Bible and turn back just one or two pages to the book of Romans, chapter 15, verse 2. And there the Word of God tells us how we should regard one another and treat one another within the body of Christ. It says this: "Let each of us please his neighbor for his good, to build him up." You know, the Bible says in 1 Corinthians 8, knowledge, just knowing things and having all the right answers, if that's all you've got, that puffs you up. It's like blowing up a balloon with air. Knowledge puffs you up, but love for somebody else seeks to build them up. It seeks to encourage. It seeks to strengthen. It seeks to help that person become more of what Jesus Christ has made them to be and saved them to be. And so the Bible says we must balance individuality with community. Finally, I want you to see a third area of balance to which God calls us. Number three, the Bible talks about balancing freedom with consideration. Balancing freedom with consideration. Look in verse 12 of the text. There the Bible says, "Thus, sinning against your brothers and wounding their conscience when it is weak, you sin against Christ. Therefore, if food," specifically food offered to idols, "if eating food offered to idols makes my brother stumble, I will never eat meat lest I make my brother stumble." Paul says, "I'm willing just to go without eating meat at all. I'll do whatever it takes to keep my brother from stumbling and to help them along in their spiritual life." Now, last weekend, we spent some time in the home of some friends of ours. They've got a grandson. He's about 1 year old, and he's learning how to walk. His name is Miles. And so Miles is just sort of learning how to walk, and I'm there with my friend, Miles' granddad, and we're in the house, and I'm sitting there. And I'm sitting, I've got my feet like this. Now just imagine, I'm sitting there, I've got my feet like this. By the way, is there anything wrong with me sitting with my feet like this. No, there's nothing. Even in church, it's okay for me to sit with my feet like this. I'm just sitting with my feet like this. And here comes Miles walking across the floor. And I see that he's just learning how to walk, just barely able to walk. He's toddling anyway. He's a toddler. He can barely walk. And I see him walking across, and I can tell that he's going to trip over my feet if I leave my feet here. So what do? I say, well, I had my feet here first. Or he's learned how to walk. He needs to learn how to walk around. If part of knowing how to walk is knowing how to walk around, so he just needs to walk around. Is that what I'm going to do? I move my feet just as quickly as I can. Why? I don't want to do anything to cause him to stumble. Well, what if I left my feet out there? What if I just left them right there, and here comes Miles, and he comes to my feet, and he trips over my feet, and he falls? Who am I in trouble with? I'm in trouble with Miles. I'm in trouble with Miles' granddaddy. I'm in trouble with Miles' grandmother back in the kitchen. I'm in trouble with my wife if she knows what I just did. I'm not just in trouble with the one that I caused to stumble. I'm in trouble with the ones who care about them the most. What does the Bible say? Look again in your Bible. It says, thus sinning against your brothers and wounding their conscience when it is weak, you sin against whom? Christ. When we fail to show consideration and cause someone to stumble, we not only sin against that person, we sin against Christ. Now, before I get up, I'm going to show you one other thing, and I'm enjoying this so much, I may just start sitting down for all my sermons from now on. All right, okay, now, imagine that it's 3 years from now, 4 years from now, 5 years from now. Miles is 6 years old. Let's say Miles is 6 years old. And I'm sitting in the house, and I'm like this. And Miles comes up, and he looks at me and says, move your feet. And I say, what? He says, move your feet. I say, why? He said, because I want to walk there. Now, you tell me who's right and who's wrong now. Now, listen, and I just say that to say this. Moving your feet out of the way to keep your brother from stumbling, to keeping somebody weak from stumbling, is different from saying, okay, I have to do whatever anybody else wants in order to appease them and please them. Does that make sense? You know, I've had people who have said, well, you know, I don't like you doing this because I don't like you doing this. The Bible says that you shouldn't do this because it's making me stumble. No, it's not making you stumble. It's just you just don't like it. And there's a difference. There's a difference. I'm not obliged as a believer to do everything that everybody else says that I am supposed to do when there's no clear word of Scripture on it. But when it legitimately causes someone to stumble. That word stumble means to fall down. It means to be destroyed. It means to be in a position where you can't get back up. If what I am doing causes someone to stumble, my position should be, I won't do anything. I won't eat this meat. I won't do anything I could do. I won't exercise my liberty and my freedom if it causes someone else to stumble and to fall down. So look in your own life and ask yourself the question, what do I do when I have a decision to make and there's no clear word from God? We know what to do when the Bible says don't do it, or when the Bible says do it. We know that we're to obey and not to disobey. We understand that. But when there's no clear word from Scripture on something, what do I do? The Bible says balance. Balance what you know with a compassion and love for one another. Balance your own individuality and who you are with the community that God has called you to, and show consideration for other brothers. And then the Bible says, balance the freedom that God has given you with a considerate heart that you would not cause your brother to stumble. That's how we're called to live the Christian life. A musician called in two of his students to play for him. And both of them had been practicing and practicing and practicing the pieces that they were to play for this master musician. One of them got up, and he had worked so hard. He had worked and worked and struggled until he could play every note perfectly. He finished. The other musician played, and she had worked hard, and she had practiced, and she had studied, and she had gotten ready. But as she played, she did a beautiful job, but she missed a few notes. After it was over, the master musician gave his assessment. He said to the one, "You played every note right, but you didn't play the music. You played all the right notes, but you didn't play the music." To the other, he said, "You missed a few notes, but you still played the music." Having a relationship with Jesus Christ is not just about making sure you hit all the marks and keep all the rules and get all the right notes. Now, God calls us to obedience. God calls us to holiness. God calls us to faithfulness to His Word. No doubt about that. But can I tell you something? If you live your Christian life with a legalistic attitude, you can get all the notes right and still not play the music. Jesus Christ, by His grace, enables us to live a life that pleases God. And even when we miss some notes, and we're all going to miss some notes, we can play the music that pleases Him. We can live a life that brings Him glory as we seek His grace and seek to walk according to His Word. I want you to bow your heads and close your eyes as we pray together. Just take a moment as we go before the Lord in prayer. Father in heaven, You've called us with all of our imperfections. You've called us with all the mistakes that we make. You've called us with the sin that dominated us and that kept us in its grips before we were saved. You've called us to Yourself, and You've called us to a new life in Jesus Christ. Lord God, I pray that by Your grace, You would empower us to live this life for Jesus. Lord God, as we deal with one another, as we make decisions that affect and influence one another, as we make our own choices about what we're going to do day by day, God, help us to live with a compassion toward others that reaches out to them in love and that's not puffed up with pride. Help us, Lord, to live lives considering the community, the church to which You've called us, that we would show love and compassion to each other here. And then, God, give us hearts of consideration, respect, kindness, and love for one another. Help us, Lord, to play the music of the Christian life the way You call us to play it. And then, Lord Jesus, I thank You for each person here. I thank You for the grace that You've shown us through Your Son. And we pray all of these things in His holy name, amen. The Word of God says there is only one God. Look again in your Bible if you have it open. One God, verse 6. There's one God, the Father, and one Lord, Jesus Christ. Then the Bible says it is for us that Jesus died. According to Scripture, Jesus is not just a way to be saved. He's not just the best way to be saved. He's the one way to be saved. And if you're here and you've never trusted Jesus as your Savior, today more than anything else, God desires to give you His gift of eternal life. And He'll do that. If you call on His name and ask Him to save you, He will give you His gift of salvation and eternal life. As we sing a final song together, Pastor Ray is here at the front. He's waiting on you. Today, if you'd like to trust Christ as your Savior, I invite you just to step out of your seat, walk down one of these aisles, just come to Ray, and all you need to say is, "I want to be saved. I want to be saved today." He would love to tell you today how you can be saved. And there are others who are here who will take some time with you. It'll only take just a few moments, but just to take some time with you, to pray with you so that you can know Jesus as your Savior. Others of you are here today, and God is leading you to this church. You've been coming here. God speaks to you here. You know that He's led you here. And today, you need to become a part of Quail Springs Baptist Church. We open the doors of the church to you and invite you to come All you need to do is say, hey, I want to be part of this church. Just tell Brother Ray, and we've got some folks here who will help you to become part of Quail Springs today. Let's stand to our feet as we stand and as we sing, You Come.
When we walk with the Lord in the light of His Word, what a glory He sheds on our way. Let us do His good will. He abides with us still, and with all who will trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Not a burden we bear, not a sorrow we share, but our toil He doth richly repay. Not a grief or a loss, not a frown or a cross, but is blessed if we trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey.
Seated. I'm so thankful that you're here at Quail Springs this morning. I want you, if you will, to please direct your attention toward our screens.
Hey there, church family. My name's Eric, and welcome to Quail Springs Baptist Church. Whether you're joining us online or in person, we're glad you're here. Let's take a look at this week's announcements. If you're new to QSBC, thank you for joining us, and we'd love to know that you're here. The best way to do that is to fill out a Connect card so we can follow up with you later this week. You can complete the card online by following the URL on screen, or if you're in service, you can grab one of the cards in the seat back in front of you and place it in the black offering boxes on your way out. Thank you again for being here. Ladies, don't forget to sign up for the No Matter What training and equipping event on August 27th. At the event, you will be equipped with a battle plan for sustaining and growing your relationship with God and others, no matter what comes next. The event will be in the Fellowship Hall from 7 to 8:30 p.m., and will also have online options for those unable to attend. Register at qsbc.org/women. This month, we are celebrating Randy Davis's 15th anniversary of being on staff at QSBC. Randy serves as the Median Adults Pastor, and we are so thankful for he and Amy's heart for ministry and how they love the Lord. Take a few minutes in the coming days to send Randy a note of encouragement and congratulations on 15 years at Quail. Next Sunday evening, we will have a special called business meeting at 5 p.m. Masks will be required, and we'll meet in the worship center for maximum social distancing. Please be aware that the meeting will not be available online due to the sensitive nature of the financial reports. We hope you'll join us in the Worship Center on August 23rd at 5 p.m. for this important gathering. Church family, we have a great opportunity to minister to internationals through a program called English as a Second Language, or ESL. This is a practical and relational ministry that opens doors for the good news to be shared. To learn more, plan to attend the informational meeting this Thursday, August 19th at 6:30 p.m. Head over to qsbc.org/events for more details or to email the ministry leader. That's it for the announcements. Thanks again for spending part of your day with us. We're glad you're here, and we'll see you next Sunday.
I'm delighted to join along with the Worship Pastor Search Committee and their recommendation to bring Lance Gibson in view of a call on Sunday, August the 23rd. I want to share with you about this committee. They have done an incredible job serving you as a church family. They've studied together, they've worked the process together, and they have prayed through this season earnestly. And so I believe that we're experiencing now the fruit of that labor.
On behalf of the search committee, I would like to thank you for your prayers and support these past months. Through this process, we have seen God's timing and His sovereignty and are excited to introduce to you Lance and Rebecca Gibson. Lance is a man who loves the Lord and shows this through his passion for sharing the gospel and his heart for discipling others.
They love Jesus. They're committed disciples but they're also committed disciple makers. And for Lance, look, he's talented, but he also has been trained as a musician, as an administrator, and now through years of ministry as well.
From the moment we sat down with Lance and Rebecca, the whole committee had the sense that this was the Lord's answer to the question we've been asking him for months. Lance is a mature, spiritually grounded worship leader with a mission, as he puts it, to make much of Jesus and to communicate the gospel. He has a clear calling on his life, gifted both musically and technically, all while remaining humble, feeling the full weight of responsibility of shepherding his team and leading worship with excellence.
His wife, Rebecca, serves alongside him in this ministry with her love for the Lord and her heart for other people. Together, they are committed to serving God and to serving his people, which we feel will be a blessing to Quail Springs.
He'll be in each of the services next week, the 8:15, the 9:30, and the 11 o'clock service. We'll have an opportunity to be able to see them, to talk with them, to hear their testimony, and then we'll also vote in bringing them on that Sunday in view of a call. So pray even now that the Lord would continue to lead us as a church together.
I can't wait for you guys to meet the Gibsons and to experience Lance lead us in worship.
Okay, what a great morning to be here. Thank you so much. Let's mind our P's and Q's when we exit. Make sure you don't cluster up. Wear your mask. We thank you so much for being diligent to help us do everything we can to keep our doors open. And God bless you for being here this morning. You are dismissed.